Please welcome the President of the General Assembly.
Hello and welcome to the official opening ceremony of the 21st session of the Model United Nations of Lübeck. My name is Leonard Brank, and it's my honor to serve as this year's President of the General Assembly and guide you through this ceremony. Before we start listening to our first speeches, we will entertain a minute of silent prayer and meditation, requested by the delegate of Israel to pay respect to the victims of the Shoah and the anti-Semitic Islamic terrorism. So please remain quiet for the next minute. Thank you very much. Within the spirit of this conference and the excitement of the upcoming week, we will start off with watching this year's Munal trailer made by our film team. Enjoy.
It is of utmost importance to strengthen the military in the state of Palestine.
May I remind you that there is no safe Palestine? It's our task to end the conflict by creating general acceptance of Israel.
But that settlement worked 70 years ago. Well, one day after the UN declared Israel as an independent state.
Let's put it that way.
That's 22 million.
Oh, but then you still owe me 30 million for protective means.
The social media corporation has provided advertising companies with personal data.
Please pay a fine of $100.
Once again,
protect our data, protect our data, protect our data, protect our data. go, the information about your employees you requested.
Yeah, that's right. So tell me, how much water can we get?
Well, I have 15 days.
I'll take it.
So, that's not enough.
And no, he would cheat. He's a cheater! You're the one to tell them. What have you done so far for connecting the world? What have you done so far for improving working conditions? What have you done so far for the greater good? Nothing. That's the problem.
I am the greater good. You are not more than my means to an end. But
don't please shut up. He's right. What have you ever done for the world or for the environment? Nothing. Because you only think about yourself. The pollution is getting worse and worse every hour. And you know why? Because there are people like you, selfish, arrogant,
don't care about every other selfish. You're selfish. Hey, Q. What are you doing? What's the big deal? I'm talking to you.
He's counting. He can't answer you.
And what is he counting, if I'm allowed to ask?
He's counting the football field sized rainforest areas that already have been cut off this year.
Anyway, I'm here to talk to you about the team. Some of them? What are you talking? What is he counting?
He's counting the number of children having died from hunger this year.
Could you please stop that? It's kind of irritating! Stop it! Stop it!
It isn't them. It is you. What do you think? Connecting or separating? Hopefully, in the end of this week, none of you will have spared any efforts in working on this issue, and you will have probably found your own individual answer to that question. And now it's my pleasure to introduce, as the first speaker today, the headmaster of the Thomas Mann School, Mr. Peter Flittinger. Please approach the podium.
Delegates, students, teachers, and most honorable guests. Welcome everybody to this year's conference at Thomas Mann School in Lübeck. Munon is a story of a thriving student project, which, however, wouldn't have been so successful without some special help. This is why I'd like to begin, as every year, with a special warm welcome to our guests who represent those institutions and foundations which support us and help us to make this event possible. We are grateful that they are doing it this year as they have done it all those years before. Without this continuous support, our students wouldn't be able to do all this. So, thank you very much. As the headmaster of the Thomas Mann School, I'm proud that our students once again have been able to set up such a conference. They have had a lot of work to do during the last few months on top of their usual schoolwork. Some of them, in addition, even had to prepare for the final examination of a German Abitur. Many thanks to my students and my personal respect for what you have organized and arranged for all your fellow students who have come to Lübeck this year. Every year, the usual business of learning at our school gets interrupted by Munon. Yes, it is a week with many consequences. 40% of our rooms and most of our equipment will be occupied in the following days. In many classes, only half of the students will be present. Regular progress in lessons would often be possible. Sometimes it is not easy for people to understand why I allow all this. Last year I said, it is in this times easier to give a reason than in recent years, because we live increasingly in a period of simplifying, of growing nationalism, of populism, of politicians who declare their own view of the world to be the only true one, who are arguing with lies they call alternative facts. It is a time in which many people seem to deserve authoritarian leadership, the kind of leadership which divides society, despises refugees, distrusts the institutions and the value system for which generations in the past centuries have fought. And now, this year, this situation I described last year has got worse. The trend was generally disappointing. Authoritarian leadership increases. Twitter seems to become an influential instrument of international politics. No distinguishing views or weighing of possibilities, neither an orientation towards common values. Only short messages put in the world, igniting conflicts and crises, endangering societies and people all over the world. Elections are endangered by internet-based campaigns which show fakes, lies, and any kind of disinformation. Social media, which presents and censors what we are already thinking, cocooning us, not opening our mind. And we deliver them the instruments for all this. Fair trade? Not at all. Instead, America first, China first, Hungary first, Russia first, and so on. Environmental protection? The others might start. Economy must grow. It must go on. Growth for several decades or new religion is more important for winning national elections, while the first people on the other side of our planet must leave their native countries because the changing climate has made them refugees. The sense of justice is deeply insulted because we must recognize that, as Oxfam published in January 2018, 82% of property growth goes to only 1% of the world population. Eight men, like Gates and Zuckerberg, own more than 50% of world population together. The distribution of wealth and income is extremely and appallingly unjust. Yes, these are frustrating facts for all those who want another way people, countries, religions, and cultures will work together, for those who are dreaming of a fairer world. Precisely because of that, Munon is one way to take part in an important and necessary mission. What gives me hope? We are part of a mission, yes. And to be part of this mission gives hope. To see my students, many different people with different social, religious, and ethnic backgrounds, working and living together in our school in a respectful and friendly way gives me hope. And to see you learning in the next day something very important, you give me hope. This conference is not only about practicing a language which enables you to communicate all over the world. This conference also offers quite a range of opportunities for individual development and important social skills. It is a conference for people who have not given up the hope for a peaceful and fair world and who are willing and determined to work toward this aim. Each topic which will be discussed is complex, difficult, needs the comprehension of different interests, necessities, views, and it is impossible to give simple answers and solutions. I am convinced that everybody should learn this lesson. There is never a simple answer possible for difficult problems and conflicts. And if MUNOL encourages young students from so many countries to adopt that view, very much has already been achieved. We need people who are resistant to manipulation and who are able to expose those who simplify reality and capable of uncovering existing problems. I hope and I wish that our students will be able to keep up the spirit of this conference this forthcoming week. And on top of all, make new friends, discover our wonderful city, and take all the things which might go wrong in good humor. I really want you to enjoy your time at Thomas Mann School in Lübeck. Thank you very much.
Mr. Bilger. Thank you very much, Mr. Fontiga, for your speech and, of course, for providing MUNOL with the necessary premises. Although most of you have already met our city's mayor yesterday, we were convinced that a representative from the Lübeck City Council was essential for this ceremony. Therefore, please welcome Lübeck's president of the City Council, Gabriele Schopenhauer.
Mr. Flittiger, dear organizers and responsible persons, especially the President Leonard Brink, Leonard Römer, and Johannes Willard, dear MUNOL participants and guests, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Hanseatic city of Lübeck, I welcome you in our town. You have come to a city that prides itself on having a history that dates all the way back to the year 1143 and is now 875 years old. We celebrate this the whole year. Yesterday evening, you have heard some historical details about our famous town hall. Most likely, you have all heard that Lübeck was once the leading town of the powerful Hanseatic League. Walking around the older parts of our city, one cannot help but be reminded of the heyday of the Hanseatic era. More than 1,000 buildings within our city have been designated as historical monuments. In December 1987, UNESCO added Lübeck's famous historical center onto its list of World Heritage Sites. However, Lübeck is not only famous for its historical buildings, but also for its reputation as a major port city. Lübeck has always been a city of merchants, its harbor being of great importance to its economic well-being. Through trade with Scandinavia and other neighboring states around the Baltic Sea, Lübeck generated an enormous amount of wealth and became, after Cologne, the second largest city of medieval Germany. Nowadays, many thousands of tourists come to Lübeck each year to visit. Lübeck's reputation has not only been established by its long-standing history as a wealthy port city, but also by the many famous people who have called this city their home. In terms of literature, I'm thinking of the Nobel Prize winner Thomas Mann and his brother Heinrich, of whom the Buddenbrook House reminds us. In addition to the Manns, there's also, of course, Günter Grass, who became famous for writing such works as The Tin Drum and Cat and Mouse. In terms of politics, I'm thinking of Willy Brandt, who won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1971 for his Ostpolitik policy. I hope you can find some time to explore our wonderful city and to decide to come again with more time. Munol is a very good chance for young people who are interested in politics and future. Already since 20 years, the Thomas Mann School hosts at the end of May this one weekly conference where they simulate the work of United Nations. Every year, there are traveling about 400 students between 14 and 18 years from all over the world to Lübeck to participate in Model United Nations of Lübeck. I'm very proud of this. The participating students slip in the roles of delegates of states and international organizations that are represented in those committees and represent the goals and ideas for their country. The simulation offers new perspectives and interesting insights in students as well as to the teachers, as one not only gets a taste of the work and the complex of problems of the United Nations, but also might improve his or her English vocabulary. In addition, the event opens up the possibility of getting to know new people and foreign cultures, and with that also a broadening of one's horizon. Likewise, one can build friendship, new friendships, and exchange experiences with others interested in global politics. We need these young people. This year's motto is Munol is globalism connecting or separating for a reason. Globalization and globalism present our society with great challenges. Many people feel lost in a world that is becoming faster and faster and in which many things only function digitally and impersonally. The influence of democratically elected governments is dwindling, and often companies decide the future of the people. The discussion you have in Munol and the experiences you have this week are incredibly important for your individual future and for all of us. I wish you a successful, educational, and exciting week and unforgettable days in Lübeck. Our society needs projects like Munol and people like you to ensure that in the end, the stronger argument still wins and nationalism has no chance. Enjoy your days in Lübeck and come again back. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Mrs. Schopenhauer, for delivering your speech and for being here today. As you may know, Munol is being organized mainly by students. But, however, in urgent cases and most difficult situations, the Munol Association is always on the spot and has their back. The association consists of former Thomas Mann students who once organized Munol themselves and now offers their help wherever needed. So please, all welcome Stina Walter, the chairwoman of the Munol Association.
President of the General Assembly, most honorable Secretaries General, Conference Managers, Financial Manager, Mr. Fittiger, guests, and most importantly, dear delegates. 10 years ago, I was exactly where you are right now. I sat in the opening ceremony filled with excitement. Excitement for what the following week might bring, for meeting new people, for engaging in challenging debates. Excitement for my very first mural. Today, 10 years later, some of you might wonder, and rightfully so, what I am still doing here. Rest assured that I do have a life besides mural, but nevertheless, the excitement that filled me during the opening ceremony of my very first mural conference still fuels me today. It is not the exact same excitement anymore. It has evolved, taken different shapes, but essentially, what remains is the realization of what mural and this experience can do. It connects. The following days will connect you on levels and with aspects you might not even be aware of right now. Therefore, I would like to use my time here today to explain to you which connections you actually might make. I will limit myself to 3 examples. First of all, and this is the most obvious one, mural, of course, connects people. When I was about 14 years old, my dad gave me a box of cards at Christmas. These cards had my name, address, email address, and phone number printed on them. Suddenly, I was a 14-year-old girl with a business card. My dad told me that I should give a card to everyone I'd meet at MUN's to build friendships, to build a network for my future. I told him that's what Facebook is for nowadays. But what I didn't really get back then was the point he wanted to make with this present and what it stood for. Use every opportunity to meet new people and to stay in touch with them. Build a network that goes beyond Facebook and the superficial pictures we all post. I would like to invite you to take a look around. And I mean really look around. I know, it's not really cool, but really look around. Try to take in the faces and be aware of your thoughts. We all see different people, males, females from different nations, speaking different languages. If you look at your neighbor, you probably see a familiar face. If you turn around, you might find yourself looking at a complete stranger who at the end of the week might have become a friend. In front of you, there might be someone who's going to annoy you in the upcoming days. But maybe even in a good way, that person might challenge you on both social and intellectual levels. Among the people you see right now, and maybe never have seen before, there might even be some who you will still know 10 years from now. Mural connects you with people from all over the world. No matter whether this will be your first and only mural, or whether you will become a mural addict, the following days will connect you. Talk to each other, challenge each other, have fun with each other, and yes, talk to the cute boy or girl at the party. Don't be afraid to connect. But that is far from all. The second connection you will make is with the world's problems and politics. Mural connects you with your awareness for what is going on around you. Just try to think of your preparation for this week. Researching your country's position, trying to understand the perspectives and the arguments, trying to anticipate the arguments from the other delegates, thinking about possible solutions. And even if you fail to think of an immediate solution, the point is
You tried. You invested thoughts, knowledge, and you became aware. This process will continue over the next days. You will discuss a lot of topics, each of equal importance. You will hear different point of views during the debates, and you will be forced to deal with them in depth. Guest speakers might give you even more perspective. And in the end, you will have made thematic connections that remain with you. This leads me to my third and last point. You will connect with your potential and acquire a whole new set of skills. Of course, your English will improve. But what is much more important, you will learn how to think critically, how to challenge different opinions, and how to meet them on a diplomatic level. You will learn how to build arguments and how to compromise. Looking at the issues on the agenda and at what is happening in the world right now, I think there's nothing more important you could learn. Those are the skills you're going to need to make a difference. Those are the skills the world needs from you. They will be essential to your future, and they might even inspire the professional path you will choose. Delegates, these three connections give you the answer to the initial question, why I'm still at Munich, even 10 years later. It has connected me on so many levels. Some of my closest friends are from MUN Times. I chose to study law and to specialize in international law because MUN started my interest in the connection between international politics and law. And I am at the board of the MUN Association because it also connects. It is a network of more than 100 former MUN participants who combine their experience and knowledge to help and assist the team organizing the conference. I love standing here in front of you, even 10 years later, filled with excitement for you, for the experiences and the connections that await you in the upcoming days. Make the most of the opportunities and connections offered to you. Make MUN 2018 your MUN, and most importantly, have fun. Thank you.
Thank you, Stina, for speaking today and for your efforts in constantly assisting MUN. As a delegate, executive member, or even as a MUN director, you most likely do not know how much money a conference like MUN actually requires. Luckily, we have our financial manager who ambitiously and successfully takes care of all issues concerning the financial requirements for this conference. Mattis, the floor is yours.
Honorable President of the General Assembly, distinguished team, dear delegates, highly esteemed sponsors, and guests. For most of you, being financial manager may sound not very spectacular, or even boring. It might sound like a job that is just about collecting money and writing bills, but that's not really true. The job is much more than that. It is about discussing important issues like finding suitable locations. It is about discussing new ideas for the conference. It is about spreading the MUN spirit to new people. Actually, it is about collecting money to make things possible and to let the ideas of the whole MUN team come true. I would even say that it's like being a delegate. You wonder why? Well, there are various letters I have to write and documents I need to prepare, which you could compare to the position papers or the resolutions of a delegate. But it's also about convincing. Convincing the sponsors to support our great conference. The result of this process for a financial manager is obviously the money, which is provided by our sponsors. Therefore, it's my honor to thank the following sponsors in the name of the whole Mule Team 2018, because without their help, a conference like Mule wouldn't be possible. So thank you to the Passierstiftung, Sparkassenstiftung zu Lübeck, Kulturmarktstiftung, Kaufmannstiftung, Michael Haukohl Stiftung, Orbus Marinekonsul, Pfiff Möbel GmbH, Lions Club Lübeck-Lubis, Bockholt GmbH, Amsel Physio, die gemeinnützige Margaret und Jürgen Wessel Stiftung, Ole und Katrin Boje, Inner Wheel Club Lübeck, Heinrich Hünicke, and a special thanks to Mrs. Boy for providing her great location for our team weekend. Thank you all very much for your help. I hope, delegates, that you too will find satisfying solution and create satisfying and good resolutions to have constructive debates during this Mule week. Thank you for your attention, and I yield the floor to our amazing PGA.
Thank you very much. Next to the financial manager, the conference management, of course, takes an integral part of organizing Mule. Therefore, please give a warm round of applause to Annika, our conference manager.
Honorable President of the General Assembly, dear Mr. Flittiger, Excellencies, Secretaries General, dear Financial Manager, Chairs, Delegates, MUN Directors, Guests and Staff. 360 days. It's been 360 days since my lovely assistant Tom and I started with the preparation for Mule 2018. We gave our best and always look forward to this very moment that our beloved PGA declares the 21st session as opened. Getting to this point were 360 productive days. Well, they weren't always productive. There were days which just had been a lot of fun, joking around, and having a good time. But many days also have been exhausting and rough, working late hours to make this conference as perfect as it can be. In those 360 days of preparation for Mule, Tom and I grew together as a team, but not only the two of us. This Mule conference wouldn't have been possible without our darling Secretaries General and our sweet financial manager, who also started planning Mule 360 days ago. But Mule would also not have been possible without our sponsors, our principal, executives, chairs, and many more people I didn't have time to mention. But I have time for one more person, and I'm not allowed to forget, and this is you. You might ask yourself, me? What did I do for Mule? I didn't start 360 days ago. Well, just consider. You show political interest. Many people don't. You support a model United Nations which simulates the UN, an institution that already exists. You make it possible that politicians and governments, officials can see that we, young adults, care about our future, care about politics, care about what is happening in our world and how we can improve things. You make a difference. I know that 1 week of Mule isn't enough time to solve all problems in the world, as well as that not one individual alone will have a solution for everything. And I know that the current situation of our world is more than challenging. But I believe, and I know, that if we continue to work together, hand in hand, show our interest, keep supporting Mule, keep supporting other MUNs and political projects, that we will make a difference together, and the efforts will not last throughout Mule, but for a lifetime. But for now, we should concentrate us on an exciting and productive week of fruitful debates, writing resolutions, and making speeches, having mutilicious fun. And remember, you're one of 300 delegates coming from 10 different countries just to participate at MUNO, and together we can. No, we will make a difference. The fact that many of you traveled long distance serves to remind us all just how important MUNO is to so many people. Enjoy your stay and be productive, but also, don't forget to have fun with the wonderful people you will meet. Lastly, before I hand the floor over to our handsome PTA, I want to say once more on behalf of the whole executive team, welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Annika. Now, having the financial resources and the required organizational achievements, the only part missing is the actual content of this conference. That's why it's my honor to now introduce the Secretary General of MUNO 2018. Leonard, please deliver your opening speech now.
Mr. President, most honorable student officers, esteemed executive team, dear delegates, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Leonard Römer, and it is my honor to serve as the Secretary General of this year's conference. After 1 year of preparation, I'm glad to stand here today and now like to introduce you to the conference theme of MUNO 2018, Globalism, Connecting or Separating. At first, it was not easy for me to plan the speech on the topic of the conference, but then I came across the following quote, and suddenly it all fitted quite well. Beyond right and wrong, there is a place where we shall meet. Welcome to the 21st annual session of Modern United Nations of Lübeck. When the Persian poet Rumi said this 8 centuries ago, we had war with knights and castles. We do not have knights anymore, we do not have any more castles, but we still have war, more dangerous than ever. When the Persian poet Rumi said this centuries ago, we had terrible disease like the plague, killing millions. We do not have the plague nowadays in that extent, but we still have deadly diseases such as AIDS. When the Persian poet Rumi said this centuries ago, we had no possibility to work during night. Today, we have the electric light, shifting our life to any time of the day. But we have the problem of light pollution. We found solutions for many problems during the past generations, but by that we also created new problems. More and more, we need to find sustainable solutions, solutions that are global, holistic, and for a long term. But when Rumi said this centuries ago, he also did not know anything about an institution such as the United Nations. Today, we do. So what has humanity achieved since then? What has actually changed? So it's obvious that some things changed, but one thing that did change is called globalism. Globalism is, first of all, a rather vague term. If you want to find out what globalism is, you need to compare how things were before it and how things are nowadays. The term globalism has been used by many different authors in many different ways, but for the use of this conference, I'd like to highlight 4 main aspects. Social globalism, military globalism, ecological globalism, and economic globalism. To stick to the previous example of war, imagine there would be war in Korea. The news that there is war, for example in Korea, wouldn't have spread that fast and wide centuries ago. Back then it would take weeks, even months, to reach other countries or other continents. Today, it would go around the world in seconds. This is called social globalism in terms of communication. So you have the news, you have the war, and what would the other countries do? Centuries ago, probably, they wouldn't care. It's too far away, the message has taken too long, it's over, we don't know. Today, the countries would clear. Some countries maybe would even intervene. This is called military globalism. So let's look a bit further. So you have the war, but you don't know what are the parties in the war. Who's fighting against who? Back then, you could imagine that it's maybe North Korea versus South Korea, I don't know, maybe you could imagine that. But today, the Korean ministry said in an official statement there's war against nutrias. Nutrias are non-indigenous, so not from there, invasive species that threatens Korea's ecosystem. This is called ecological globalism. Why are the nutrias there? Because Korean people like to eat them. But if you look at the economic aspect of globalism, you can see that this may change quite soon. So the aforementioned things are four main aspects of globalism. We have the social globalism in terms of communication with the fast message, we have the military globalism with the other countries, we have the ecological globalism with the nutrients, and the economic globalism, for example, the worldwide operating brands. They have something in common. They're all about far distances becoming small. And you already noticed there are connecting aspects, for example, the faster communication and the possibility to buy products worldwide. But also, there are separating aspects such as the invasive species and military operations by other countries. During this week, you discuss quite different topics in quite different forums, but in almost all of them, you will find something that connects them to globalism. And you will see that there are connecting as well as separating aspects of it. So globalism has two faces: studying abroad, easier travel opportunities, and pineapples in winter on the one hand, and companies exploiting other and poorer countries and humans. Global players dominating whole markets and invasive species on the other hand. Now the important thing about this is that globalism is a man-made process. It is something we created, something we have the responsibility for. And it is something only we can influence. That's why we have to take the responsibility, and that is why we have to take action. But what can we do about it? So it's not that easy, but one thing that is for certain, globalism cannot be stopped. It just can be used in different ways. And we'll figure out the way we use it. We're all different, come from different countries, speak different languages, but we all have the same goal. It's like when you tie two birds together, they cannot fly, although they have four wings. You, as representatives of the different countries, are the birds. And you have to figure out the direction together, but flying is something each of you has to do on their own. And that's what you're going to do, discussing the direction we want to take. We will never be as other indigenous cultures, we'll never fully understand them, and they will never be as we are. I will never be as one of you, as well as you will never find an equivalent as well. One could say everybody lives in their own world. But where these worlds cross, where we share a world, those are the places where we can meet. It is task of every single one of us to push these worlds together. That's why you're here, that's why you're at Milo. When preparing this conference, the question I often ask myself was, what is Milo about? What is Milo about? And one thing, definitely not the only thing, but one thing that came to my mind was negotiating. Let me explain that, negotiating. Imagine you're in a house, and inside the house is a yard, and your friend's in the house as well. And you're on opposite sides of the yard, in the hallways, looking to the other side. And you see that the opposite wall is completely red. And you say, hey man, what a strange house with red walls. And your friend says, can't you see? They're white. And maybe you're not that intelligent or you've never been to an Amian conference before, and so you start to argue and you say they're red, your friend says no, they're white. Who's right? Well, the truth is that half of the walls are red and the other half is white, and together they make the flag of Poland. So what you have to do is change perspective and put different points of view together to get the bigger image. And one more thing, if you turn the flag of Poland around, or in this specific example, if you just switch positions, it is not the flag of Poland anymore. Then it is the flag of Indonesia or the one of Monaco. So you see, there are always at least two sides of a medal. First, you have to review the situation before you can take action. That's one thing that MIRL and also the United Nations in general are about. And that's what you're going to do during the next days. But apart from the debates, I want you all to enjoy the famous MIRL spirit. MIRL spirit. What does it mean, MIRL spirit? Many people from different countries, you, traveling far distances, informing themselves via the internet, coming together, talking about global matters, enjoy an unforgettable week, get to know other cultures. Later maybe stay connected via Instagram or Facebook or WhatsApp. I know that, traveling to other places, talking about global matters, getting to know other cultures, using the internet to inform yourself to stay connected. You know, this is globalism. MIRL is globalism. And we are the privileged here at such an amazing event. And for us it's great, once again it's great, it's connecting. But have you ever wondered why some countries don't evolve? They are not integrated in such processes because to do all this, to travel to other places, you need money. And exactly that is what poorer countries are missing. Who's listening to the poor? That's one thing. But the other thing is, what do we really want? Do we want to help poorer countries? Yes. But do we want to renounce all our luxuries in our everyday life for this? So you see, it's not that easy, and that is why we chose this conference theme. To raise awareness how lucky we are. And especially, on whose costs. And once again, I want you all to know, and here I'm quoting the Lord of the Rings movies, that even the smallest person can change the course of the future. This is our chance. Let us prove venerable to our ancestors as well as to our children. Let us be the craftsmen under the roof of the United Nations, renewing and keeping the columns which carry it. And that is why I call upon you. Be prepared, be a driving force, be groundbreaking, be a change in the world. Good luck. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Leonard, for the speech and for explaining what this conference theme actually stands for. Keeping this in mind, we will now continue with listening to a former youth delegate of Germany who is now working at the United Nations in Geneva. She's going to talk about her personal experience and work regarding the Sustainable Development Goals and their connection to globalism. Please all welcome Elise Zerak.
Today to be with you. It's only feels like yesterday that I've actually been sitting on your side, eager to understand the big challenges of our times, eager to find solutions to transform the world, eager to make new friends. Just like Stine Walter, it actually is now more than 10 years ago that I myself participated in MUNOM. The world was quite different back then.
The internet was spreading, and there was the idea that globalization would not only increase global wealth, but that it would also benefit all people on our planet. Globalization seemed like a miracle that enabled us to move ourselves and our minds and our words and our pictures and our ideas and our teachings and our learnings around the planet at an even faster and an even cheaper pace. Not only did the world change tremendously over the past decade, but so did my life. It was here at Model United Nations of Lübeck that I first truly understood the importance of global governance. I wanted to get more involved. I decided to study international relations. I became youth delegate and accompanied the German delegation to the United Nations General Assembly. Now I work for the United Nations in Geneva. As we say in Geneva, New York might be the political center of the international system, but Geneva is its operational heart. There, I work for the United Nations Economic Commission for Europe. That's one of the five regional commissions coordinated by the Economic and Social Council. Over the past decade, not only my life changed, but so did the world. I feel that globalization has taken us by surprise, and we've been far too slow to respond to it. It is true that globalization increased global trade, global wealth. It is true that the number of absolute poor has been reduced and that living conditions have been improved. But it is also true that globalization has been a factor of increase of inequality. As Mr. Flittiger has said, it is only eight persons in the world that own as much wealth as half of the world population. As long as we hold on to an economic and social model that drives exclusion and environmental destruction, people die, opportunities are missed, the seeds of division and future conflicts are sown, and the full force of climate change become ever more likely. It is time for us to admit that we are not making an awful lot of progress against an awful lot of challenges. We have now got to figure out, that is actually you have got to figure out, how to globalize the solutions better so we don't simply become a species which is the victim of the globalization of problems. So, how do we achieve these advances? We certainly need to elect politicians that have minds that telescope. Politicians who see the bigger picture and understand that we don't only need a national but a global perspective. We certainly don't need politicians which minds that only microscope, that only look in and regard everything foreign as a threat. We need to ask our governments to feel more responsible of what happens around us. In fact, all of us need to think a little more in a bigger picture. What we also need is countries to collaborate more. As challenges are more and more global, we also need global answers, and we need more forms of multilateral governance. In my opinion, there's enormous potential of the United Nations 2030 Agenda on Sustainable Development. The 2030 Agenda was adopted 3 years ago in 2015 by all UN member states and includes 17 Sustainable Development Goals. These 17 SDGs aim at eradicating poverty, achieving gender equality, and establishing more sustainable ways of producing, consuming, and living by the year 2030. The power of the SDGs actually lie in their universality. They apply to all states. All governments have committed to the implementation of the Agenda 2030, and now it's time for all countries to deliver. In my job, I assist the governments of Europe to implement the SDGs. In my opinion, the SDGs can actually bring the fair globalization that the world needs at present times. In fact, it's the SDGs who became what we wanted them to become, the roadmap to guide our collective efforts to create a better world. However, we need to change gear. We have hit the post-2015 ground walking. Now we need to pick up pace and start running towards 2030. The magnitude of our challenges has yet to be met by the measure of our actions. Recognizing this, the 2030 Agenda is about a fundamental shift in the dominant development system. The scope of our ambition may be global, but the real action of implementation has to happen on the ground in national, regional, and local contexts. Politics needs your debt, but so do all of we. We need to be the change we want to see in the world. We need to be responsible consumers, practice values such as gender equality in our daily lives, make our lifestyles more sustainable. Model United Nations might only be a simulation of the UN, but what you will discuss in the forthcoming days is very real. Use the knowledge you gain from these days to tackle actual challenges. There's one superpower left on the planet. That superpower is us, the 7 billion people. The 7 billion people of us who have caused all these problems, and the same ones who will resolve all of them. Remember that you cannot be too ambitious, you cannot be too creative, you cannot be too collaborative in the search for solutions. Take what you learn in the next days with you. Take it with you and make it reality. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Arek. It was a pleasure having you here today. As the next speaker, I would like to introduce to you Justin Rogotsky, a voluntary member of Terre des Hommes, an international humanitarian charity organization for children's rights. Justin, please obtain the floor.
Distinguished President of the General Assembly, Distinguished President of the General Assembly, Honorable Secretary General, dear delegates, it's with honor and great pleasure to be standing here in front of you and to be representing the Terre des Hommes Germany organization. We are a children's aid agency that is concerned with health benefits and sustainable development all over the world. We are part of the Terre des Hommes International Federation, which is present in over 14 countries and spread over two continents. We are right now, Terre des Hommes is a consultant to your Economic and Social Council. We were founded in 1967 due to the devastating impressions of the war in Vietnam. At first, we concentrated on first aid actions, like flying injured and wounded children to Germany and provide them with mental and health care. Since then, 50 years have passed, but there's still a lot of work to do. We are nowadays supporting more than 400 projects in 34 countries. Our international federation supports more than 1,000 projects in more than 50 countries. The aid we provide is supposed to go to local projects and to help local authorities to improve their situations. The German Institute of Social Issues has certified us for the last 25 years with a certification of good donation. That means that we report objectively, we advertise moderately, we present our funds to the public, and that actually means that we spend more than 80% of everything that we get on our projects. Less than 5% is for the administration, for staff and our offices. As a matter of fact, there are still 300,000 children soldiers and 3 million starving children every year. More than 100 million illiterate children are right now in the world, so there's still a lot to do. Our organization itself is not large enough to do that, so that's why we are here to plead to you to help us, but also There's the fact that social globalization weakens the knowledge that indigenous groups have in their regions. Every 2 weeks, one language gets extinguished. There are right now about 6,000 languages in the world, but 98% of all websites are occupied by only 12 languages. There are a lot of things that we need to consider and a lot of things we have to do. And this is why we're standing here, pleading to you to not forget the weakest, but still the most important people that are in the world, our children. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Rogatsky. To inform all of you, we will collect money for Telkazon to help those children. So there will be boxes passing around, and yeah, it would be nice for you to put some money into it. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we will come to what you've all been waiting for and assembled here for today. I hereby declare the 21st session of the Model United Nations of Lübeck as officially opened.